Russia launches airstrikes on rebels in Syria after they seize large parts of the country. In the biggest escalation of fighting in years, insurgents have taken control around the city of Aleppo, forcing hundreds to flee. Also tonight, the assisted dying bill is facing problems before it's even launched. Family, political friends and foes all pay tribute at Alex Salmond's memorial service. And
this is ITV News with Shehab Khan.
Good evening. Syria tonight appears in turmoil after government forces pulled out of the city of Aleppo following a shocking and swift advance by rebel groups opposed to President Bashar al-Assad. The offensive, led by a faction once linked to al-Qaeda, has forced thousands of civilians to flee in fear. The rebels now hold large swathes of the country, posing the biggest threat to the president for years. The Syrian military says plans for a counter-attack are already underway, and Russia has responded with a barrage of airstrikes targeting rebel positions. Our correspondent Sam Holder has the latest.
For years, this bloody, brutal civil war seemed in stasis. But in the space of just 3 days, Syria's second largest city has fallen. The vast majority of Aleppo is now under the control of Syrian rebels. Thousands of fighters from Hayat Tahrir al-Sham, or HTS, an Islamist opposition group, swept southwards through villages and towns to reach the city. When they arrived, they tore down this statue of President Bashar al-Assad's late brother. Government soldiers have withdrawn, the military say, to prepare for a counter-offensive. Meanwhile, the rebels have now advanced further south, approaching the city of Hama. Russia, which has backed Assad throughout the civil war, carried out airstrikes in part of Aleppo in response, reportedly killing almost 30 civilians. Aleppo, which holds great significance in Syrian history and politics, has been under government control for the last 8 years, when Russia helped by bombing the city to ruins, displacing millions. But international factors have weakened Assad's position.
The Syrian army so far has not fought back. Over the last year, since October 7th, Israel has been bombing Syria at least 3 times a week. And so that's weakened Syria and has weakened its ally Hezbollah and Iran, so they can't come to reinforce Syria as they have.
Syria's civil war began as a result of pro-democracy protests back in the Arab Spring. Hundreds of thousands have died in the following 13 years. Since 2016, Assad has held almost every major city in Syria. The question is whether this rebel advance has been a success because of its surprise nature, or whether it's a sign of things to come.
And Sam joins us now. Sam, this has wider implications, does it not?
Yes, that's right. But look, very, very quickly, we have now seen some comments attributed to Assad, which say he will continue to defend Syria's integrity, but we still haven't actually seen him. But look, when you talk about the wider implications, Syria's international supporters are much weaker than they were in the past. Iran, one of the major backers, has been weakened as a result of essentially the decimation of Hezbollah in the conflict with Israel. We've then got Russia, who are involved with the in Ukraine. That's taking up a lot of their time and resources. They can't back Assad in the same way. Assad himself is much weaker, and he is facing an opposition who are ideologically driven, linked, as you said, to al-Qaeda, who have clearly been waiting and preparing for this opportunity.
Yeah, concerning time in the Middle East. Sam, thank you very much. There have also been violent scenes in Georgia following days of protest there. The US condemned what it called excessive violence by police against demonstrators in Tbilisi. Violence erupted after the government announced a halt to EU membership talks on Thursday. Large numbers of riot police, some using water cannons and tear gas, have been deployed to protect government buildings, including the parliament. Now back to the UK. The assisted dying bill is already facing significant obstacles on its path to becoming law. Some MPs who initially supported the legislation yesterday are warning they may withdraw their backing if changes are not made. Meanwhile, a stark warning from the hospice and palliative care sector, who are calling for assurances that their services won't face funding cuts to pay for potential NHS costs that may result because of these changes. Our political reporter, Charanpreet Kera, has more.
While some celebrated, others commiserated. Now it's down to the detail.
Assistance to leave!
For those who oppose the assisted dying bill, the fight isn't over.
I was very distressed at the result because I just think those issues of coercion were not fully taken on board. There is time now to really have a deep engagement with colleagues, and I think they will be pleasantly surprised about how much palliation can make a difference to people at the end of life and give people the comfort and care they need.
300,000 patients across the UK receive that comfort and care every year. Last year, hospices got a third of their income, £678 million from the government, and had to raise a further £1.3 billion themselves, double what they had to raise 10 years ago. Some fear if this bill passes, that'll only increase.
It's not been made clear in Kim Ledbetter's bill how assisted dying would be funded. Would it be a fully state-funded service? Would hospices that are charitably funded be expected to provide it? Would it be funded privately? These are questions that are unknown.
Do you think the cost of implementing assisted dying could eat into palliative care budgets?
We're not in a position where we can afford for less funding to come into palliative and end-of-life and hospice care.
One of the many issues to be addressed when the bill passes through committee stage.
At this point, it's about the principle of the bill, that we believe people should have choice. So it's not a perfect bill. I don't think anyone is advocating that it is perfect in its current forms. I think there's definitely scope there to improve this bill.
After committee, the bill will return to MPs for a third reading. While some hope that will improve the safeguards, others want it voted down for good.
Charanpreet is now here. How likely is that to actually happen? Could it get voted down?
It could, Shehab, but there's every chance that this bill could fall at the third reading. If some of those MPs who voted for it yesterday change their mind, or if they're not satisfied with the scrutiny that it's subjected to at committee stage, MPs do still have questions about the practicalities of implementing this bill. One MP who voted in favour of it, Jo White, the MP for Bassett Law, said she wasn't sure who would pay for legal challenges if, for example, somebody didn't agree with the decision of a judge, or could GPs get in trouble if they did assist somebody to die and family weren't happy with it? Answering those questions will be difficult. It could take months, and that's before the bill goes to the Lords, at which point all of those stages of scrutiny will repeat. If the bill overcomes that and becomes law, there's a two-year buffer period before any assisted deaths will actually happen.
Yeah, one to keep an eye on. Charanpreet, thank you very much. To Ireland now, where counting is underway following the general election. Exit polls have suggested that the three major parties are neck and neck, but the leader of Sinn Féin insisted tonight that her party had broken the state's political mould. From Dublin, UTV's political editor Tracy McGee sent us this update a short time ago.
Counting got underway early this morning, but the Irish voting system is complex, and that means that the true picture may not be known until Monday. That said, politics has changed here. Since the Irish state was formed over 100 years ago, two parties have dominated, Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael. But now it's confirmed that the Republican Party, Sinn Féin, has become a serious third player.
This has been really an incredible performance by all of our candidates, by Sinn Féin across the state. Over a short number of weeks, we have achieved a result that many people a few weeks ago would have thought impossible.
All three are locked in a tight race. It appears that Irish voters struggling with the cost of living and housing crisis have not plumped for a clear winner. There have been shocks, including the news that alleged crime figure Jerry the Monk Hutch could take a seat in Dublin. Irish elections are a two-phase process. First, voters have their say, then the parties try to form a government. We do know that it will be a coalition government, but we probably won't know how it has been made up until the new year.
Tracy McGee in Dublin there. To Scotland now, where a lone piper played as the man who fought tirelessly for Scottish independence, the former First Minister Alex Salmond, was honoured at his memorial service today. Family, friends and foes, including former Prime Minister Gordon Brown, heard him described as a leader of courage and vision. But his successor, former First Minister Nicola Sturgeon, was not present. Our Scotland correspondent Peter Smith reports from St Giles Cathedral in Edinburgh.
It is St Andrew's Day, but these Saltire flags were not for Scotland's patron saint. On Edinburgh's Royal Mile, this was Alex Salmond's Day, a memorial for the former First Minister after his death last month. He was the man who led Scotland to the brink of independence before a bitter split from the SNP. Salmond claimed he had been betrayed by once close friends, and his loyal supporters let the current SNP leader know they had not forgotten. Notably, Nicola Sturgeon decided to stay away today, avoiding a similar hostile reception. Today was not an occasion for feuds. Friends and foes came out of respect for one of this century's most formidable politicians. But Alex Salmond is also a complicated figure to eulogise.
We gather not to beatify a saint, but to remember a human being.
Some of Salmond's favourite Scottish musicians were here playing a patriotic soundtrack.
That I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me, now I'm going home.
This was a reflection on the legacy of Alex Salmond, the man who almost broke up Britain, but refused to give up hope.
But for Scotland, the campaign continues, and the dream shall never die.
But I can't understand.
Salmond lost that referendum, but still reshaped the landscape of Scottish politics. When you started singing about Scottish identity, given we see how far Scotland has come, how much do you think that is down to the legacy of Alex Salmond when you're here today?
I think Salmond is the pivotal figure of the last 30 years in Scottish politics, whether you support independence or not.
As Alex Salmond's family have just left St Giles Cathedral, the crowd here have begun a spontaneous rendition of Scotland's national anthem.
When will we see his lights again? I don't know. He's the greatest politician we've ever had.
He'll fight on and get me stream.
For 300 years, Scotland's future had not been in the hands of the Scottish people. Alex Salmond changed that. His widow left the memorial today knowing her husband's work ensures that dream of independence will now outlive his time in politics. Peter Smith, ITV News, Edinburgh.
Now on to the football. Arsenal are up to second place in the Premier League tonight after they thrashed West Ham 5-2. Chris Scudder has the action.
If anyone can catch Liverpool at the top, it might just be Arsenal.
Who else but Gabriel?
Paul was irresistible. Saka was at his best too, winning a penalty, dispatched by the skipper.
Hits the right spot.
And that is it from us. The weather is next, but from me and the whole team here, good night.